Today is Mother's Day, and we want to acknowledge all the women we're blessed to know. We rejoice over you, for your strength, your wisdom, your strong love, and your beautiful faith. Whether today is a celebration for you or a day of quiet reflection and healing, we're thinking of all of you. If you gave birth this year to your first child, our joy overflows and we celebrate with you. If you adopted a child this year or became a foster parent, we rejoice with you and we want to honor you in your commitment to changing the lives of children. If you continue to struggle with infertility, we are hoping with you and holding your hand in prayer. If you are exhausted and feeling underappreciated for all you do for a house full of kids, we applaud you. We love you, and we appreciate you more than you can ever imagine. And if you lost a child this year to death or miscarriage, we weep and mourn with you. And if your child is lost to addiction or to the world, we hurt with you. And we join you in putting our hope in the one who brings prodigals home. If you live with painful memories of your mom, we pray that you will find in a spiritual mother all that you never had from a birth mom. And if you're one of those amazing spiritual moms, we thank you for stepping up and being there when others couldn't. If you're experiencing an empty nest for the first time this year, we walk with you in this new season and are excited about the next chapter God has planned for you. If you're single, we celebrate your strength, beauty, and individuality, and join with you in praying for the desires of your heart. If you're a single mom and wonder if you have the physical energy and financial resources to raise and provide for your child or children, we want to help you, and we will. And if you're pregnant for the first time, we prayerfully anticipate with you the joyful birth of a healthy child. And to all the special women on this Mother's Day, rest and delight in knowing that we are thankful for you, and we celebrate each and every one of you.
Well, good morning and happy Mother's Day to all you moms out there. We are so grateful for you and we are thankful for you. As we prepare ourselves for worship this morning online, wherever we are, a couple announcements for you. A reminder that we are pushing forward and asking you to connect together via groups. If you are not in a small group or a discipleship group of any sort, whether a Bible study, Sunday school class, or a regular during the week sort of group, we want you to be a part of that. We want you to get connected. We want that to be one of the main ways that we find belonging here at College First. And so you can sign up for that by going to the College First website, collegefirst.org. Look for the resources tab, and there you'll find a place to sign up for groups. And that'd just be a phenomenal way for you to find people to enjoy fun and fellowship, to learn about Jesus together, and to be on mission together. Secondly, I want to remind you that we are in the midst of 31 days of prayer and fasting as we walk through the month of May. And so hopefully you found a way to fast during this month, whether in small ways every day, or whether you've chosen a whole day to fast from food and to be praying for what the Lord is doing and what the Lord will do in the days ahead, both for us as a church and for our community. So be fasting, be praying, sign up for groups. Those are really important things for us right now at this moment. But as we look forward to worship today, as we think about being sent as our theme throughout this service, we're going to hear a prelude this morning. And as we do, I want you to take time to rest and to abide, to lay down the things of your week, to lay down things that are on your mind, to slowly, steadily connect with Jesus. As that music plays, remember what you love most about the Lord. Remember how he's called you into his life, into his presence. And let that be the foundation for stepping into worship and to step into mission, as we'll talk about throughout today's service. So ponder those things, meditate on those things as the prelude plays.
As we worship this Lord's Day, it is good to be together, such as we are. We're trusting that you sense already now the presence of the Lord, and we certainly welcome him into our presence this day, into our midst, and most importantly, we welcome the Lord into the center of our hearts. Let's worship him as we read responsively our call to worship, the congregation reading the gold italicized print inspired by Jeremiah chapter 29. A word of encouragement came from the prophet to the people.
Live a life that is full. Build, plant, eat, love, multiply.
Pray for your communities.
Keep God in the center of all that is.
We enter into worship today with hope in our hearts.
For something happens here that reminds us that we can live as God desires.
God has made a promise of faithfulness to us.
And we can trust the promise.
Let's sing together. I worship you. We worship him. Let us join our hearts as we sing in praise and adoration.
Alone are worthy. Would you join me in prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, thank you for having us gathered together in your presence today before your throne. Thank you for the ways that you are using us in our various lives, in our various roles, in our various callings, that you have set us apart to each as unique and different. And today, Father, we especially praise you and thank you for mothers, that you have called many people to raise children. That, Father, as these mothers are leading little ones, perhaps grown-up ones, that you would gift mothers your wisdom, your discernment, Lord. That you would give them clarity and insight, so that way their family, that those that they are raising, will come to know you and come to love you, Lord. We ask that you would bless them and that you would guide them on this Mother's Day, Lord. Help them to understand the great role you have in the work of your kingdom, Lord. And we also acknowledge that on this Mother's Day, there are some with heavy hearts, with grieving hearts. Today, for those who are missing their moms, would you meet them where they are at in their grief, Lord? For those who desire to be moms, but for whatever reason are not, Father, would you hear the cries of their hearts? Would you comfort them in the moments of brokenness, whatever that might feel for them, Lord? But we thank you for the roles of our moms, the ways that they have influenced us, shaped us, and formed us. Father, thank you for the gift of family. Thank you for the gift of community. Again, we praise you for the ways that you are using every single one of us. We acknowledge that we have been far from perfect, so we ask for your forgiveness for the ways that we have fallen short. But Father, continue to use us, mold us, help us all to look more like you today, Lord. As we continue to worship together, refresh us, renew us, Lord, so we may be sent out to follow you closely, to draw others unto you. Thank you for these moments together. It's in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that we pray. Amen.
Waters, my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
To the part of worship that is just for you. So parents, you can tune out, But be sure to come back in just a few minutes. So kids, this morning we're going to start with three questions, and they're going to be true or false questions. So true means that this is correct, it's right, this is true. False is no, that's wrong, that's false. Okay? So if the answer is true, raise your right hand. And if the answer is false, raise your left hand. Okay? All right. First question. God created us. Ding, ding, ding. True. That is correct. God created us. All right. Question two. God has a plan and purpose for each one of us. Ding, ding, ding. That is true as well. And the third question is a little bit trickier, but you guys are smart. I know you'll get it. So question three. We are where we are for a reason. That one is also true. So God created us, and when he created us, he had a plan and a purpose. And he put us in our families, in our neighborhoods, in our schools, on our soccer teams. He put us there for a reason. Now let's think for a minute. Do you know what that reason might be? If you know, tell your neighbor, whether that's your parent or your dog or your sibling. Go ahead and tell them. All right, so that reason is so that we can show God's love to others. Now guys, believe it or not, there are people that don't know God, and they might be closer than you think. They might be your next door neighbor or a person on your soccer team or in your ballet class. So it's always important to show God's love to others. But how do we do that? Well, some ways are really easy. We can write cards to those that are in the hospital or are sick. We can help deliver meals to those who might need them. When we're at the grocery store, we can ask our mom or dad if we can buy an extra box of mac and cheese to put in one of the little free pantries. It can look like that. But some ways are a lot bigger and a lot harder to find. So this week, I want you guys to take some time and to pray and ask God what ways that you can show his love to those around you. What are the best ways that you can do that? Last week, we talked about listening to God and hearing him, right? This is a great way to practice that, to practice listening to what God has for you. Let's pray. Dear Father, I thank you so much that you have created us so special, and that you have a plan for us, and you've put us in our families and our schools for a reason, and that reason is that you want us to be examples of your love to others. Lord, we ask that you help us do that, and we ask that you help us figure out what those ways are, what the best way is for us to show your love to others. We thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name, amen.
This morning's scripture is found in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verses 1 through 14. This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This was after King Jehoiachin and the queen mother, the court officials, and the leaders of Judah and Jerusalem, the skilled workers, and the artisans had gone into exile from Jerusalem. He entrusted the letter to Elisha, son of Shaphan, and to Gemariah, son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to King Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. It said, "This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, good morning again. We continue today in our series thinking about what does it mean to be the church? Because as we walk through this season, we recognize that we can't just be stuck in one place. We can't just wait for things to change, but we have to continue living into the calling that we have to be Christians and the calling to be the church. And so we've explored over the past several weeks, what does it mean to be the church? What are the different functions? What are the different aspects that come with being a people of God? And we've talked about being a gospel people, a people full of good news that share that good news, the story of Jesus and our own stories as God has intersected. We've talked about being a connected people that need to find our tribe and our extended family to be tied together, to do life together. And we've talked about being a listening people that makes space and place for God to speak to us, to hear that, and to focus in on that. And then, of course, today is no different. We're going to talk still about what does it mean to be the church and to be a sent people, to be a people that are on mission. Now, I've been here for several months, been a part of the church and helping to lead the church here at College First. And you may have noticed that the term mission and being on mission is something that comes up quite often. It's a passion point for mine. Of mine, that we have to get out of our comfort zones, that we have to push the edge. We got to go to uncomfortable places to meet those who are the least, the last, and the lost, to meet those that are at the margins, to meet those that don't know Jesus. Because if we don't, we're going to find ourselves in positions where everyone around us are people that already follow after Jesus. And certainly, because we've talked about being a connected people, there's nothing wrong with being around other Christians, but we have to find ourselves being around non-Christians as well to help share and tell the good news of Jesus Christ and to live out, to demonstrate, and to show that good news of the kingdom coming here on earth as it is in heaven. And for the people of Israel, God's people, many, many years ago, it was a similar situation. As we've heard in the reading for today from Jeremiah, that they found themselves in a place that was uncomfortable. They found themselves in a situation, in a circumstance that they did not like, perhaps not very far from the situation that we find ourselves in, and one that we probably don't like and makes us uncomfortable. And for a lot of the voices that were around them at the time, they kept being told that it would only be a short time that they would be in that position, that they only had to be uncomfortable for a little while, for a year, 2 years, before they'd be able to leave that place and get things back to normal. And as you hear that passage, as you have heard that passage, and as we talk about that today, it's going to be really easy for us to think about this passage in terms of the pandemic, the situation we find ourselves in. But I want to stretch our thinking a little bit beyond the present circumstance to the entirety of our lives. That we often find ourselves in places that we may not like. That maybe you are at a job that doesn't seem quite right for you. Maybe there's a coworker Maybe there's someone you know that's a part of your work family that just rubs your nerves a little bit. Maybe you find yourself in a neighborhood where you don't like your neighbors across the street or the neighbors next door. Maybe you even find yourself in a family where you have a sibling, a cousin, a family member that just grates you the wrong way. We can often find ourselves in situations and in places where it's not comfortable, where it's not what we would prefer, where if we had the choice, we certainly wouldn't have put ourselves in that particular spot at that particular time. And whether that's perhaps the pandemic today, which we could probably all name that, or any other place in your own life where you just aren't quite satisfied with where you are, I want you to think about that in terms of the people of God, the people of Israel. As they found themselves in exile, they were in a place that they didn't like, and they were ready to get up and to get out as soon as possible. That was their hope, and that was their dream. That's what they were hearing, and that's what they were longing for. But when they heard the word of the Lord, the passage that was read for us, the Lord didn't say to them, "Don't worry, it's only going to be a little while." The Lord didn't say to them, "Hey, I know you're uncomfortable, but in just a brief moment, you're going to be comfortable one more time." Instead, the Lord said this. He said to build, and he said to plant. He said to build up your lives right where you are. He said to put down roots, to plant yourself right where you are. Not just because it's going to be a long haul, which he does say it's not going to be 2 years, it's going to be 70 years. Not just because it's going to be a long haul, but because there's something significant that you can do in the place that you are, in the time that you are. And again, we might find ourselves in the present moment, in the circumstance of a pandemic, and the Lord might be speaking to each and every one of us that you are in this place and in this time, and don't necessarily run from it, but to build up and to plant. Or whatever situation you might find in the more normal aspects of life, a job you don't like, family that may be a little rough, a neighborhood that might be a little bit less than preferential. What if the Lord is calling us to build up and to plant down? To think about our lives in terms of plants and foliage and trees and shrubs, all those sort of things, that there is a necessity for us to not just dig down deep, but a necessity for us to build up. And not just a necessity to build up, but a necessity for us to plant down deep as well. And we see that sort of theme, to build and to plant, throughout Scripture. And in particular, a passage that may be very familiar to you is Colossians 2, 6 through 7, which says, "So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught and overflowing with thankfulness." I think there's a calling that when we find ourselves in uncomfortable situations, when we find ourselves in the places that we are, whether we like them or whether we don't like them, that there's a calling for us to put down deep, deep roots down into the soil and to soak up the best of what it means to be in relationship with Jesus. To work on our covenantal relationship with him, to find fellowship and friendship with Jesus. And it's the same time as we're digging down deep roots to pull the nutrients from relationship, to feel that deepness of abiding with God. There's also a calling to build up ourselves, to be above ground, to have a stalk and a stem, to have leaves and foliage, and eventually to give kingdom fruit. And for that to happen, you have to have what's above the ground, and you have to have what's below the ground. You have to have the stem and the stalk. You have to have the leaves so that the fruit can be bore. But if there's no roots underground that are soaking up that nutrient, bringing up water, etc., then the plant can't live. We have to have those deep moments of abiding and rest with the Lord, as well as kingdom work that comes above ground in the stem and in the leaves. And as we look at this particular passage, we see that there's a call to be for the community, to think about building ourselves up, to be working for the best of what God has to offer for the people around you. We have to be for our communities. We have to be for our cities. We have to be for the people that are around us. And in this passage we hear, seek the peace and the prosperity of the city that you find yourself in. And I think there's a calling for us that as we find ourselves again in those workplaces and those families and those neighborhoods and whatever other situation you might find yourself in that you wouldn't prefer, or it is where you are right now, that God is calling us to seek the peace and the prosperity of those places, to work to bring the kingdom of God there as it is in heaven. Now, when we hear to seek peace and prosperity, we can often look at that through the eyes of Western mindsets. We hear prosperity and we might think wealth and finance and money. But when the scripture says peace and prosperity, it is only one word that shows up in Hebrew, and that is shalom, which we often interpret as peace, but it's far greater and far more significant than peace. To say shalom is to say that may everything that is broken in your life and in your world be made right. And so as the call is to seek the peace and prosperity of the city, we're actually being called to seek the shalom of the city, to seek that everything that is broken with it would be made right. And as you do that, the passage says, as you seek the peace and prosperity for the city, then you too will find peace and prosperity. That as you seek to make everything right about what is wrong with your community, with your neighborhood, with your work, with your family, with your city, wherever you are, that you'll find that everything that is wrong in your own life will find shalom as well, will find its rightness and its right place. So we are called to be above the ground, to grow, to flourish, to plant kingdom seeds wherever we go, to work for the prosperity and the peace, the shalom of the places that we find ourselves in, to be for our community. But at the same time, we're called to be of the kingdom of God as well, to be people with deep roots, that be people that are tuned in to the Holy Spirit, that are tuned in to God and hearing what he says about us and about our community, to be so rooted in Jesus that no other voice could distract us, that no other pathway could be temptation for us, that no other element of this world could be better than what Jesus is for us, because we are so deeply rooted in him. We have to be of the kingdom of God. And we hear in this passage that there's many other voices that are being cried out to the Israelites. And there's statements of, don't listen to those, ignore those, and listen to what I have to say instead, because I am God. And as we seek that peace and prosperity, as we seek that shalom, as we seek to be above the ground with our stalks and our stems, our leaves, looking for fruitfulness in the world around us, we have to have those deep roots tied in, tuned in significantly to God, to that covenantal relationship, so that we can actually produce the fruit that needs to be produced. We have to be below ground, we have to be above ground. We have to have covenantal relationship, and we have to have kingdom responsibility. We need both to be at play. We have to build, we have to plant, we have to be rooted, we have to be built up. We are for our community. We are of the kingdom of God. And in doing that, we recognize that as both of those are held in tension, as both of those are calibrated together in our lives, as we live out our lives, we can be confident of what the Lord is doing, that he knows the plans that he has for us, that he has scattered us like seed to put us in the places that we are with purpose and with a plan. That job you may not like, maybe God has you there for a very important purpose. Maybe the family that kind of grinds you the wrong way, maybe the Lord's got you there for a reason. Maybe the neighborhood, maybe the classroom, whatever it is, that place, maybe God's put you there because you're the one that needs to be there. And we have to have confidence that as the Lord has scattered the seed of the gospel in us, and he scattered us where we are, that there's a plan and that there's a purpose in that. As those seeds fall, wherever they may fall, as you find yourself in the position wherever you find yourself, be for your community, be of the kingdom of God, and be confident in what the Lord is doing. Because we know that God can use you anytime and anywhere, even when it's not your preference, even when it doesn't seem like the best situation, even when it's really hard and really challenging. God can use you anytime and anywhere. He has sent us to every nook and cranny of this world, to every industry, to every neighborhood, to every family, to every classroom, to every farm if you live out in the country. He has sent us everywhere so that the good news of Jesus Christ would be planted and built up all over the world. But that's up to you to send down those roots, to build up the stalk, and to lay out more kingdom fruit for what the Lord wants to do in your midst and in the lives of the people around you. We are a sent people. We are a scattered seed meant to share the gospel and to bring the kingdom of God here on earth as it is in heaven. So I challenge you this week to think about this. What would it look like for you to bless your community, to bless your neighborhood, to bless your family, to bless your classroom, to bless your job, to bless the farm, county road that you live on? What would it look like to bless them? To maybe stand at your front door, on your front porch, on your front stoop, and look at the neighborhood around you and to pray God's blessing on each and every person that's there, that they would have shalom, that everything that is wrong in their lives would be made right. What would it look like to begin to demonstrate, to show what that rightness is? To lend a helping hand, to mow your neighbor's lawn, to offer words of encouragement when they're downtrodden, to seek the rightness of their life in prayer, but in practicality as well. How can you bless your community? How can you bless the place you are this week? And we put together a little guided prayer sheet for you to help you think of a multitude of different elements and categories of your life that you may want to begin praying for and asking God to bless. And we've included some specific words for you to pray. You can use those if that's helpful. If you want to pray your own prayer, that's fine too. But to help you think about all the different areas that God has put you, has sent you, has scattered you as a seed of the gospel, and how you might bring blessing to those places, firstly through prayer, and secondly through practice. We encourage you to take that time and that space, particularly as you pray and fast through this month, to pray and to bless for those around you, to be for your community. Stay rooted in the Lord, be of the kingdom, and to be confident of the plan that he has for you. And as we do all of that together, as all of those pieces are held in tension, as we live them out, may we see great kingdom fruit in our lives. May we be surprised, may we be shocked by the way that shalom comes to us as we seek shalom for other people. We'll be surprised by the rightness that comes into our lives as we seek the rightness in other people's lives. And may God bless our cities and communities. And may God bless us as we seek the kingdom fruit that comes through living our lives deeply rooted in him and built up in the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen.
God has spoken into our lives today. God is speaking into your life this day. What shall we do? Where shall we go? To whom shall we speak? Let's try to sort this out as we pray today. How shall we live now that God has spoken into our lives? May he hear the prayers of his people. Brothers and sisters, let's sing together as we prepare to pray.
Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. When we call, answer us. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Come and listen to us. Oh Lord, hear our prayer. Oh Lord, hear our prayer.
Would you join with me as we pray together? O Lord, hear our prayer as we ask for your blessing over our communities. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we do seek the peace and the prosperity of every place we find ourselves. We seek, Lord, and ask for that shalom, that everything that is wrong in the world around us would be made right. We pray, Lord, for some specific areas in our world. We pray for our families, Lord, that you would bless them. Bless not just our immediate family, those maybe that are around us even this morning, but Lord, would you go beyond that into aunts and uncles, grandparents, grandchildren, nieces, nephews, cousins, and the like. Would you, Lord, take all that is wrong there? Would you make it right in their lives? Would you bless them, Lord? We pray, God, that you would be at work, not just in families, but in neighborhoods as well. We pray for our neighbors, Lord. We pray for your blessing upon their lives. Lord, whatever hurts and habits and hang-ups, whatever past relationship issues we may have, or whatever's wrong in their own lives, Lord, would you fix? Would you make right? Would you bring peace? Would you bring blessing, Lord? We pray for our schools, pray for the children that are in the schools, we pray for teachers, we pray, Lord, for all that are on staff. Certainly, Lord, as we recognize that there is much that has been wrong about these last couple months, we pray, Lord, that you would bless all those involved in our schools, that you would seek and make happen the peace and prosperity for them that maybe they desperately need right now in this moment. Pray for all of our local churches, Lord, for all the Christians, our brothers and sisters in Christ, that as they wrestle with a multitude of issues, as they too are separated from one another as we are separated, as maybe they've even experienced loss during this time, Lord, would you bring blessing to them? Bless our brothers and sisters in Christ. Bless their communities. Bless their church families, Lord. We pray, Lord, for your blessing and safety and in peace amongst our community. That, Lord, you would protect health, that you would guide decisions, and you would bring a sense of unity and healthy relationship amongst all those that make up Findlay and Hancock County and beyond, Lord. Lord, would you bless each and every person that makes up our city, our county, and our community? We pray, Lord, for all those that are in leadership in our community, for those that are bosses, for those that are politicians, for those that lead nonprofits, and whatever other capacity of leadership, Lord, would you bless them in their decision-making? Would you help them to have peace prosperity, Lord. We pray, God, we pray that through all of that, through each part of our world that, Lord, needs you so desperately, we pray for our own selves. That, Lord, whatever is broken, whatever is wrong in our lives, would you make that right today, Lord? Would you bring your shalom into our spirits and into our hearts? Would we find peace and prosperity with you, Jesus, above all other things? We pray, Lord, for this blessing, knowing, Lord, that you are gracious, that you are good, and that you, O Lord, have heard our prayers. Pray all these things in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, remembering what was said in the passage, or in the sermon this week, let's remember that God can use us anytime and anywhere. And let's sing this song together.
And so now, as we think about closing our time of worship, there's still some singing to do, still some praising to do, still some trusting to do, and certainly there's still work and mission to do anytime, anywhere. God can use us. God can use you. Let's rejoice in the goodness and greatness of God as we sing together. I'm gonna live so God can use me.
I'm gonna live so God can use me anytime and anywhere. I'm gonna live so God can use me anytime and anywhere. I'm gonna work. I'm gonna work so God can use me anytime and anywhere. I'm gonna work so God can use me anytime and anywhere. Oh, let's pray. I'm gonna pray so God can use me anytime.
Refuse to waste our lives for your
thanks for joining in worship together this morning. And as you go, a blessing for you, a blessing that the Lord would show you where to ask blessing in your life. May God show you the places that need his peace and prosperity most, that need his shalom most. And would he guide you in praying? Would he guide you in demonstrating and showing that good news, that rightness for the wrong that maybe surrounds you? And as he does, and as you work to see the kingdom of God here on earth, may he bless you immensely through kingdom fruit and through deep roots of relationship with him. Go in peace, be well, and we'll see you next Sunday.